We're at Point Lobos, which is a state reserve in the California State Park System, located a little bit south of Carmel on the Central California coast. This reserve is often called the crown jewel of the state park system, and so it sees a lot of traffic. It is also interesting for geologists, and that's because here in the park we actually see the preserved remains of an uplifted ancient submarine canyon. Nearby here, just off to the north, are two modern submarine canyons that cut the modern slope that leads down into the abyssal plain of the Pacific Ocean. The largest of these is Monterey Canyon, the smaller is Carmel Canyon, and these are conduits by which sediment is moved from the beach and from the rivers like the Salinas River down into the deep sea. We can't actually walk on the canyon floor, and so our understanding of it is limited by remote sensing tools and dredging samples and things like that. But here we can actually see what the long-term fill of sediment of such a canyon is like, because it's been uplifted, partially eroded back, and so we can actually walk down inside the guts of the fill of this ancient submarine canyon.
Submarine canyons are actually different all over the world. Some of them on coastlines that are relatively not tectonically active, like in the Gulf Coast of the United States, often are filled with mud because there isn't a lot of coarse debris that's available. The fill here is very coarse. It's composed of coarse gravel, cobbles and boulders, as well as some sand and finer things, but it's very coarse. And it's coarse because there were mountains nearby. You were eroding them down and dumping the coarse debris down into the head of the submarine canyon and then flushing it out into the deep sea.
There are really two kinds of questions that we ask here. The first is a basic science question, and that is, what are the processes by which sediment moves into submarine canyons and comes to rest? And there are features within the geology of the park that allow us to answer some of those questions. But those can be translated over to the second reason that we come to study places like this, and that is oil and gas exploration. It requires really a special set of geologic circumstances for oil and gas to accumulate. Submarine canyons are one such environment, yet they're so far below the sea surface and even farther below the bottom of the sea floor that it's impossible to know what they're actually like. That's why coming to a place like this where you can explicitly walk on the sediment floor 55 million years ago and understand where the reservoir sediments are and where they aren't, this gives us an opportunity by analogy to consider what kinds of things may occur deep beneath the earth in those places where we're looking for oil and gas. And by doing that, we potentially reduce some of the risk involved in exploration in those places. One of the wondrous things about the national park system and the state park system here in the U.S. is that many of the parks are there because of geology. And while most people come to see the magnificent scenery or maybe the wildlife, we geologists go to a place and we see all of those things, but we see ancient landscapes unfold before our eyes. So here, it's as if we're able to go in a submersible to the bottom of the ocean 55 million years ago and see what's going on, see what's being deposited, seeing boulders falling off the side of the submarine canyon walls. It's just a sort of way to even more deeply appreciate the parks that we have here in the U.S.
It's a case of clues. It's like forensics. We try to find features that tell us precisely how this was moved or what was happening, how strong the current was. These rocks, like virtually all other sedimentary rocks, are layered. Makes sense? Oldest stuff is on the bottom of the pile and the youngest stuff is on the top. So there's an order to this. And so it's a little bit like a history book. Each layer represents an event and the vents stack up, but sometimes between events nothing happens. So you don't get anything deposited. And it's as though in a history book you came in and tore out some pages. And so you get a record of what this king did, and then suddenly somebody else is doing something. And you don't know what happened in between. But if you use your geologic record carefully, you can put together a pretty nice history, even if there are holes in it now and then.